is to never worry for my. Good afternoon, everyone. I love looking at everyone's bright faces. Are we ready to praise the Lord? We ready to sing praises to our Lord Savior? All right. Well, will everyone please stand and sing with me? I feel like traveling on.
Amen. Welcome back. Let's pray and bless this offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for another opportunity to meet together, Lord, to worship your precious and holy name. We pray once again for this offering, that it would be used for great and mighty works, for your honor, for your glory. We ask all this in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
We got two new praise songs that we want to share with everyone this evening. I know that y'all won't know them, but you may have heard them on the radio. So we are asking everyone to stand. Join us in praising. All right, good. Everyone, please stand. Sing with us.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We gather together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves. Our God saves. There is hope in your name. Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We gather together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that our God saves. Our God saves. There is hope in your God saves. Our God saves.
Yeah, yeah. All right, everyone, let's put our hands together.
The joyful sound of our offering, as your saints bow down, as your people sing, we will rise with you, lifted on your wings, and the world will see that. Yes, the world will see that our God saves. Majesty, Lord of
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. It was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace.
My chains are gone,
my chains are gone, I've been set free.
Ransom
me,
and like a flood, His mercy,
His mercy reigns.
Unending love,
unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, I encourage you to turn over to Nehemiah chapter 1. Good to see you all out this evening. The Lord. So tonight we're going to preach and share on change. That's just the title, change. I've shared several times before that change must occur in order for growth to happen. That's individually, but also that means collectively. We talk about the church especially. There has to be a healthy amount of change. It doesn't mean that we change things just to change things, just because we want things changed. No, that doesn't mean that's the answer at all. So, tonight we will look at change and healthy change. We'll look at why, what, how, and all that good stuff. So let's pray and we'll get into it. Father, we come before you. We thank you for allowing us once again, Lord, to gather here freely. God, we are so thankful that you've given us your word, so thankful that you've given us your spirit. God, that we have just this great opportunity to open what you've given to us and, Lord, be ministered to, convicted if necessary, encouraged, exhorted. Lord, whatever you choose, whatever you see fit, Lord, I pray that you would accomplish that tonight. And, Lord, that you would once again just use me as a vessel. God, that you would be honored, you'd be glorified, your words would be spoken. And, Lord, again, you would bring us into a completely unified body. And we'll praise you for all that you do. We ask it now in Jesus' name. Amen. So, there have been some changes here at TBT, obviously. There's been physical changes in the building. But there's also been spiritual changes. There's been emotional changes. There's been mental changes go on. And I will say it again. I want you to understand something. There's no change that's happening just for the sake of change. We're not saying we need to change this because we want to change it. Nothing is happening like that. I'll say this first of all. Every bit of change that goes on, prayer has been put into it. First of all, by me and also by the elders, by our staff, we have prayed about the things that have been done, discussed it. And so it's not just, we're not just doing things just to do things, add things, take things away. That's not what's happening. But the second thing is this. Any change that has occurred in our church or will occur in our church is for this reason, to further cultivate us as a church in our attempt to accomplish the Great Commission, fulfill the Great Commission. So everything that we do is going to be an effort to cultivate that. Make sure that we are doing everything we can do to see that we as a church are accomplishing and fulfilling what God's called us to do. So let's first begin with this. What is our purpose as a church? Why do we meet here? Why do we have a local assembly here in on the edge of Saginaw here in Fort Worth? What is our purpose here? I believe I just said it. Fill the Great Commission. But I'll go even further tonight and expound, elaborate a little bit, if you will, and say our purpose is to be the body that glorifies the Lord, first of all. A body that glorifies the Lord here in this local area, but also a body that edifies one another, lifts one another up, encourages one another by the utilizing and the exercising of the spiritual gifts that the Holy Spirit has given to every single member. So that's the second thing we're supposed to do. But we're also to be reaching the lost with the gospel of Jesus Christ within every effort that we can have. So we are to be doing that. After we're reaching the lost with the gospel message, we are then to baptize them, and then we are to disciple those who are one. Why? So that they, in turn, will reproduce, and the kingdom of God is advanced. That's the purpose that we have a local church in this area right here. That's the church's purpose everywhere. No matter where you go, that's what a church is supposed to be doing. If you come to church and you want to be entertained by the music, that's the wrong purpose for the church. If you want to be entertained by the speaker, that's the wrong purpose of the church. If you want to have a great children's ministry, youth ministry, that's the wrong purpose to be in a church. The church's purpose is stated, just as I said, all throughout Scripture. The whole counsel of God's Word. Again, we talk about the church specifically there in the New Testament. So, if that's our purpose, then we as a church have a vision statement that clearly says that we are a praying church with a passion for God and a passion for people. Now, that is Matthew chapter 28. And that's also found in the Great Commandment. We have a responsibility to love God, to love one another, and to fulfill, again, what He's called us to fulfill in the Great Commission. Tonight we could take the opportunity to look at a lot of examples when we're talking about growth, we're talking about change and seeing growth. Look at the process of change. Look at a lot of biblical examples. We could actually look at our Lord Jesus Christ. We could look at His ministry on earth and see how He radically brought change. Very bold example of change. He came into a world that was very religious. The people were religious, focused on religion, focused on man. And He came there and basically dropped a spiritual bomb on their whole agenda and on their whole program. He radically changed what was going on there in Israel. We could look at everything that he did. That would be a great example. But tonight, I want to look at an example of a man who God used to bring about change that was in effort to glorify God, to make sure that God's will was accomplished, and see the people get on board with that. So I want to highlight a few of the things that he did before that we read a little bit in the text. And I also will point out that this is what is implemented or needs to be implemented for any needed change. So if you've taken notes, you can jot them down. I'll try to go slow. But here is something. If we're going to see good, healthy change happen, especially speaking in the spiritual realm, here are some things that have to go on. First of all, we have to remain spiritually sensitive. Because if we never are sensitive to the Holy Spirit in our life, we will never change. We'll never hear the voice of God through His Word. We'll never be spoken to. We'll never have that communion with God in prayer if we're not remaining spiritually sensitive. So again, we have to stay in a state of spiritual sensitivity. The second thing that we have to make sure to do if we're going to see healthy change in our life that brings about growth is we have to make sure that we're continually seeking the Lord. Because I'll say this, there's a lot of people that I've seen and experienced, and I've probably experienced it in my life in several different areas, but you stay spiritually sensitive and you feel like something needs to go on, and so you may see some of these next steps that we're about to see, and you avoid that step of continually seeking God. You start seeing the potential and the needs, and you start seeing all these things, and you say, yeah, this is what needs to happen. But you forget seeking God's face. And so you got to continually seek the Lord. But the third thing is this. Anytime there's needed change, you always have to identify the needs or identify the problems. I mean, is there a problem? Is something wrong? Does something need to be changed because it is wrong? You have to identify the problems. The fourth thing is that, to assess the needs in that situation. So if you're remaining spiritually sensitive, you're continually seeking God, you're identifying problems if there are any, maybe there's not a problem, like as far as an offense, but maybe there's a problem in something that you're not doing, something that you're omitting. So identify the problems and then assess the needs. What has to be done? What has to be changed? What is it? And then once you do that, then you have to definitely address the logistics. You have to see what you need to do in order to see the change come about. You've got to realize, okay, this needs to change. These are the problems. This is what has to happen in order for it to happen. And so when you address the logistics of how this change is supposed to happen, then you can purposefully plan, and you can also purposely prepare. I just made that purposefully say it. There you go. Thank you. Somebody need to be able to say it. So red here. But you have a purposeful plan. Purposeful. There you go. Plan and prepare. In this change. But then the seventh thing is this. This kind of completes it, if you will. There's a next one. But the seventh thing is this. You have to actually implement the necessary change. You can talk about it. You can see the need. You can assess everything you need to assess. You can address logistics. You can plan, you can prepare, you can do all those things, but when it comes down and if there's change that's needed, you've got to implement the change. You've got to say, this is what I'm doing. This is what I'm going to stop doing. This is what we're going to do. This is what we're going to stop doing. You've got to implement the change. But something that I added to this, and it doesn't work out because seven is supposed to be the perfect, number of perfection and stuff, but number eight, we're throwing it in there as an extra. You have to stay faithful in opposition. Because any time, you can call this follow through if you want to. Number eight is follow through. Because any time that you implement change, and it's for the Lord, for God's glory, for your good, something that God has ordained, God is in it, then I'll say this. You'll find plenty of opposition. You'll find a lot of adversity. You'll find people, you'll find things, situations always coming against you. I'll share just one small example that probably every Christian, if you've been a Christian for any amount of time, has tried to change in their life. Maybe you've experienced a successful change in this, but maybe, on the most part, I think a lot of Christians at some point in time, again, struggle with this change. I need to read my Bible every day. You know you're sensitive to the Spirit. There's a message that's preached or the Spirit just convicts your heart. Maybe it's about prayer, but you're sensitive and you realize there's a problem and you begin to evaluate and you identify these things. You assess and say, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to find a devotional. So you start planning, preparing, you start doing those things, and you even begin to implement the necessary change. You are going through this devotion. You're going through this yearly reading plan. You're going, and what happens in this endeavor of change? You never find time. There's too much noise. Every time that you go to do it, your mind's racing. There's too many distractions. It's just opposition, opposition, adversity, even though you know this is a healthy, needed change so that I will grow. And so that's what we'll look at tonight. These are some steps, again, we'll see, that Nehemiah took in a change that was necessary in order for God to be glorified and for there to be right growth there in Israel. So in Nehemiah chapter 1, we're just going to read the first chapter, and then we'll highlight a couple other things in the following chapters. But verse 1, it says, "The words of Nehemiah, son of Hakaliah, it came to pass in the month of Chislu in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the palace, that Hananiah, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah." Listen to this. Here shows the sensitivity. "Now ask them concerning the Jews that had escaped, and then which were left in captivity, and concerning Jerusalem." He was staying sensitive to what any needs were, what any necessary change, what was going on with the state. He was remaining sensitive. Verse 3, "And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also was broken down, the gates thereof burned with fire. And it came to pass, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven." There's a lot of steps that could be wrapped in just in that right there. But one thing is very clear, that he was instant and he was faithful. He was continually seeking God's faith. He was mourned. The Bible says certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. He was making sure that he was seeking God's face. Something had to change. Something wasn't right. Something was very wrong with what God's plan was for Jerusalem, what God's plan was for God's people. Something needed to change. It wasn't just okay that some of them went back to Jerusalem, that the temple was built and the altar was rebuilt under Zerubbabel and Ezra. It wasn't just enough. The city was still broken down. The people still weren't experiencing everything that God had intended for them to experience. So he's brokenhearted. Something needs to change. Something has to be done in order for the walls to be built, in order for God to be glorified, in order for us to experience and do what God wants us to experience and to do. So he goes on in verse 5 and hear a little bit of his prayer. And he said, "I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let thine ear now be attentive and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night." See that? He's continually seeking the Lord. "For the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee. Both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments." Remember what we were talking about this morning? Faith and obedience to God's commands? He's pointing out, this has been our problem. "Not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgments, which thou commandest thy servant Moses." Remember, "I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if he transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if you turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out unto the uttermost part of the heaven, yet I will gather them from thence and will bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. Now these are thy servants and thy people whom thou hast redeemed by thy great power and by thy strong hand. O Lord, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name, and prosper, I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. If we look in chapter 2, in verse 17, it says, Then I said unto them, You see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach. You know what? He had admitted to God in prayer, Listen, we've messed up. It's not that we've gone and done all these bad, horrible things. That was probably part of their account. But that they had left off obeying God's commands. Not doing very clearly what God had commanded them to do. If you do this, then I will bless you and protect you. It doesn't mean your life will be perfect, but I will bless you if you obey me. And in his prayer, he says, this is what we've messed up in. And now he's talking to the people. He says, listen, let us go and build the wall because we've been a reproach to God in disobeying his commands. We wonder sometimes why the church is so ineffective in America today. It's because I believe we become a reproach to the name of our God. We've said we don't want to do everything he's commanded us to do. We are comfortable. It's convenient to have church as a country club. We don't want to do what we want or what God wants us to do. I'm not saying that's everybody in here, but the church, for the most part in America, just wants to exist. They don't want to do. They don't want to go and fulfill the commands of God. And so we see, I believe, a great reproach on the church. Therefore, there's a reproach on the nation. That's what I wholeheartedly believe. The church, the true church in America, would rise up and obey the commands of God, would be the light, would be the salt, would speak the truth, would live it out. I believe there would be a different story in our nation. That's just what I personally would say. I don't agree with that. I think that we'd still be going down the toilet. I think that we could be going down the toilet because of leadership. I don't think that we'd have leadership if we were doing what we were supposed to be doing. And so we see him charging them, let's rise up and build. Let's do these things. Let's make sure that we're doing what God wants us to do and no longer being a reproach to them. Verse 18, Then I told them of the hand of my God which was good upon me, and also the king's word, because in chapter 2, the very beginning, he goes directly to the king. He's attending to the king. The king says, Hey, what's wrong with you? You're not sick. Why are you so heavy-hearted? And he said, Listen, this is the reality. This is what's going on back in Jerusalem. And so he says, God, help me. That's a paraphrase. He basically says a quick prayer, God, help me. And he begins to ask the king for every bit of resource. He begins to plan and prepare. He begins to assess what he needs to see change happen. The king makes everything open to him and available to him. And he comes to this people, and that's what he's saying. Hey, God's hand has been favorable. We have an opportunity. We have liberty. We have freedom. We can go out there. We can do these things right now. God's hand's been good to us. And they said, Let us rise up and build. Let's change it then. Walls are broken down. We've been a reproach to the name of God. We've not done what God has commanded us to do. So you're right. God has commanded. God wants us to do this. God's favor is upon us. The opportunity is before us. Let's rise up and build. And what happened? They didn't just say, hey, okay, we know what we need to do. We've got all the resources. We've assessed all these things. This is what we've got to do. They implement the needed change. Look what it says. So they strengthen their hands for this good work. They begin the work. They begin to gather and to go to do what they were supposed to be doing. But if you have your Bibles, or you can do it on the screen, the next verse. Look at the very first word. But. There it is. When you intend to make a needed change, and a right change, there's always going to be a but. That word right there, you can circle it, underline it, you can say opposition. Because that's what it goes on. When Sanballat the Horonite, and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, and Geshem the Arabian. Those guys came on the scene and they became very, very, very instrumental in keeping them. Just nagging. Attacking them. Distracting them. Discouraging them. Attacking them. Everything. But if we skip to chapter 4. After a lot of work for change. a lot of work in the change. And again, there was plenty of opposition up to this point in chapter 4. We come to verse 6 in chapter 4. And look what it says. So built, that two little word, we. So built we. He didn't say, so the leaders built the wall. He didn't say, so a few of the Israelites built the wall. Again, if you go back in chapter 3 and you begin to look, each person has their own area. Each person and every family has taken part in rebuilding the wall. They took hold. They took ownership. They made it their own. And they said, we're strengthening our hands for the work and we're going to go and do it. We're going to do our part. Even if they had a small part of the wall to build, well, I'm not very significant in this work. I only can do this much. It doesn't matter. Do what you have. Is that your part of the wall to build? Build it. Be a part of it. So built we the wall, it says. Go on, it says, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof. For, look at that, the people had a mind to work. Not to exist, not to sit, not to enjoy and be comfortable, but a mind to work. There was a needed change. There was a reproach upon the name of God because of their disobedience. They were ineffective and they had experienced the consequences because of it. And now, Nehemiah saying, we're going to go back and do what is pleasing to God. We're going to build. We're going to set up. We're going to do what is in His will. People bought in because they realized it is clear. That's what God wants us to do. Just as we saw this morning, faith and our response should be obedient if it's true faith. I believe God's word is God's word. I believe that everything He said in it is true. I believe everything that He commanded for us to do, we are to do. If that is absolute faith, then we should have complete obedience. Sometimes I think we struggle in our lives and we wonder why we are struggling spiritually. And I think sometimes it's because there's sin in our life. Sin of omission. Again, as I said this morning, we begin to negotiate the commands of God because we know that in our disobedience, we experience conviction. And so we say, not every church does that. Just because that was just for the first church. We're not necessarily supposed to do it exactly like that. We begin to try to negotiate. I think that we struggle sometimes with things that we don't need to struggle with. If we would just be honest, just like Nehemiah, God, we've sinned. We're being disobedient. We're not obeying Your commands. We're trying to do things the way that we want to do, and we're just kind of existing in captivity and not experiencing everything that You've promised that You would give to us. That abundant life. But I'll say this evening, that's the key in that verse 6. So built we. The we. The we had a mind to work, and they worked. They did the necessary work. Again, not just existing, but the actual work. And it was the right work. It was the good work. Again, in our church, we've had some changes. And we will have some changes, but all for the right work. All for the work that God has called us to win souls, to disciple those who are saved, to edify one another so that we can live that life of being the light and the salt. But we're doing things, and we're changing things, we're starting things. Again, only an effort to further the work. I can honestly say this, before some of the things that we have started that we are starting, I don't believe that I could stand before God and answer yes if He asked me this question. As the pastor of that church, did you lead my people in a way that church was doing everything they could do to fulfill my will? Before some of the things that we're doing, I don't think that I could. I think I said, well, we could probably try a little harder in this area. Well, we could ensure that this was going on. We couldn't just say people need to do it. We could really facilitate it going on. But I'll say this, with every bit of belief I have, we're moving in the right direction. We're going down the right road. And that's what God desires, for us to strive together for the faith of the gospel. What every member of this church has to come to grips with or let go of is this. I'm going to be a part of that we. I'm going to strengthen my hand for the work. I'm going to be a part of building that wall, of doing God's will, of doing that work, because that's what God has called us to do, the work. And so what are we doing then? I'm saying this, we're being very deliberate in some things. We deliberately are trying to reach the lost with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're deliberately trying to reach our community. We're trying to reach out around the world. We're deliberately doing these things. We're also deliberately trying to teach others to do the same. So some of the things that we're doing in deliberation, some of the things that we're going to begin to do, is a few things I want to talk about tonight. And that way you have an idea. You're not kind of finding out secondhand. You can hear it right from me. The first thing is this. Weekly outreach will continue. Every week, every single time that we have the opportunity, we're going to go out into our community and try to give the gospel. So I exhort you and I urge you, have a mind to work. Strengthen your hands for this good work, for this effort. Rise up and help us build. Weekly outreach is going to continue. The second thing that's going to continue is our community outreaches. Special outreaches that we have, like in the apartment complex or the Spanish ministry. Continue to try to reach Spanish-speaking people. If God brings somebody who has a desire to minister to Laotian, we're going to do that. God, whatever. We are going to try to reach our community, again, through special outreaches, homeless outreaches. We'll do anything else God allows us to do. Like we did our fall festival. We're going to do it again in October. We're going to go down the park on October 31st. When everybody's out, we'll hand them out candy, but we've got a greater purpose there. We're going to have Christian music displayed there, singing about Jesus Christ, and we're going to hand them the truth about Jesus Christ as they come through there. We're going to be a light in our community. We're going to continue to do that, and we're going to be faithful in doing that. Next thing that we're going to continue to do is have a focus on worldwide missions. We're going to try to cultivate and be exposed to through mission trips. And again, continue with our mission support and try to raise our mission support through mission works, through our missionaries, praying that God will raise up and call out more missionaries, more workers. We're going to continue down that. That's the focus of the church. That's the purpose of the church. We're praying, continually praying that God would afford us the opportunity for our church to partner with, to start new churches, plant churches, revitalize churches. We want to be used up for the kingdom of God, wherever and however God will allow us. That's what we're going to continue to do. There's some new things that we're going to start, we're going to implement. The first new thing that I want to talk about is this, is First Steps class. Our First Steps class is basically providing a doctrinal conduit from new membership to service. So what we've found is in the time that we've been doing the new members class, it's going to be about 4 years when we come into October, we'll have been doing our new members class. And what we found is that some of you have gone through new members class, you realize where we stand for the most part and what we expect of new members and what our take is on new members and we've explained a lot of the different processes and ministries and tried to funnel you into serving and using your spiritual gifts in this local body. Well, one of the things that we've also seen is a disconnect from that new membership to actual service. Some people, boom, it happens right away, no problem. But we want to make sure that we're giving you everything that we can possibly give you in a four-week period of time, that we can further equip you, we can strengthen, we can encourage, we can, again, funnel and conduit from that new membership to service in the local body. So we're going to have a First Steps class. We'll do this once a quarter. And again, this is not just to create something, but this is seeing a need to help make sure that we are getting the fullest potential from our membership as possible, from our new members to our oldest members. And so this First Steps class, four-week class, it's going to be once a quarter. So if you went through, let's say, for instance, if you did the new members class in June or July or August, and we have a First Steps class in September, we're going to ask you to go to that class. And so there'll be 3 months' worth of new members in that class, that way you're not there and you're by yourself. So we're going to try to give you, again, just a real good power pack punch of Bible doctrine. Again, just encouraging, facilitating, and helping get people plugged in further in the local church service. So that's the First Steps class. The next new thing that we're going to do, we've been talking about already, many have already enrolled in it, is our Wednesday night reproduced discipleship class. And so it's not necessarily a class, that's not right, that's discipleship ministry. It's going to be the mentorship. We've already had the self-assigned mentor where two people are put together and they arrange a specific time throughout the week. But now, again, we were talking about earlier about being deliberate. We are going to be deliberate. We're taking people out of Wednesday night service, people out of service in other ministries, and saying we want to have an opportunity where there's people who maybe their whole week is used up with family and work, and they honestly don't have a spare hour to go through this. So we say, okay, we're going to invest that time, we're going to invest that resource in those who desire to have a firmer stand in their faith and desire to be used in the kingdom work. So Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock, beginning on September 10th, we're going to begin a one-on-one. You're going to be one-on-one, ladies with a lady, men with a man, and you're going to walk through 20 weeks of discipleship. Very intense. You're going to be exhorted, and it's going to require you to memorize Scripture. It's going to require you to write Scripture. It's going to require you to be faithful to study God's Word, to be in prayer, to create prayer. You're going to have all kinds of things, but I promise you this, at the end of that 20 weeks, if you're faithful to it, you're going to realize, man, I feel a lot more confident in my faith, and I have a lot more Scripture memorized, and I feel better equipped to witness, whereas maybe I didn't before. So Wednesday nights, we're making that deliberate effort. So still, if you have a desire to sign up on Wednesday nights, we're running out of people who are available to mentor, but hey, that's a great problem to have. You say, I want to do that. I want to be strong, have a stronger stand in my faith and be able to witness better as a Christian. Sign up. I don't care if you've been in this church for 20-something years. I don't care if you've been a Christian for your whole life. If you can't say, I have a firm stand on what I believe, no question. Somebody came, I could give an answer for the hope that's inside of me. If you're not there, don't have any pride, don't have any of that. Just go through it, get the tools needed so that we can build the wall, so that we can do what God's called us to do, everybody. So we're going to do that. Prayerfully, we'll see more laborers enter into the harvest, into the labor, into the fields. Through this, I believe that we will. But that's an investment. That's a long investment. And we're taking deliberate measures for that. And the next and the last thing that I want to talk about as far as change goes is we're going to call our leadership conference. We're going to give an identity because it's taken on a different form and different focus moving forward. And we're going to call it P3, for Praying Passionate People, P3 Leadership Conference. We'll be able to identify what was talked about, what was discussed. And so that's what we're going to do every year. We'll still have a leadership conference. It will just be this. But here's the different take that our leadership conference, many of you have been in our church, you've experienced this. We, the elders, deacons, in the last couple years, the ministry leaders, we've gone away. And when we come back, there's a new theme. There's a new something presented, and it's preached on, taught on, materials are printed, and that's our yearly theme. God really challenged my heart with that idea, I think that we could do a better job of unifying the church body under the direction that God has us going. And so what we are doing is we're going to pray for what God has for us to do. This yearly theme will be clear, It'll be pointing to the vision of the church, but it'll also facilitate a church-wide integration. Again, all an effort to unify not only the leadership, but the membership for God's glory, for God's mission. And so, again, it's not just the change, it's to change. Well, we need to change something. What are we going to change? Let's change this. No, we're not doing that. Again, it's been through prayer and say, this is what are some things that we need to do to ensure that we're unified. And on that note of being deliberate, on that note of being very concise in what we're doing and try to ensure that certain things are done, specifically the Great Commission, that's pretty wide, broad vision there. I want to share something. Maybe that's where a lot of people get hooked up, is the Great Commission. I'm just not comfortable. I want to share a few things, some reasons why many Christians aren't evangelistic, even though they claim to be. So here's reason number one. We fail to be biblically responsible for doing evangelism ourselves. We fail to be biblically responsible for doing evangelism ourselves. Instead, we think it's the responsibility of another person, or the responsibility of a specific program or a specific group of people to accomplish evangelism. The second reasons why many Christians aren't evangelistic, even though they claim to be, is we fail to put evangelistic opportunities, listen, on our calendars, on our to-do list. We fill out our calendars, fill out our weekly schedule, we fill out all these things, and some people even doing family events, activities, all these things, but we don't schedule. We don't plan for evangelistic opportunities. Again, many people are evangelistic in theory. I mean, I care about the lost. I want to see the lost saved. I want that to happen. But we'll never be evangelistic unless we are intentional about it. And we deliberately set aside time each week to give the gospel. Participating in the church's outreach effort on a weekly basis is a good way. It's a good offer. That's why we're being deliberate, to facilitate everybody being a part of getting the gospel out. You can do that as well as being involved on a personal basis. Take a coworker to lunch, share the gospel with them. Take a neighbor, invite a neighbor to, if you're not going to knock on their door, invite them over. Give them the gospel. Number three reason is we fail to be consistent in our evangelistic efforts. Here's a what if. What if we committed to doing just one thing evangelistically each week? Each person in here. We've got probably over 100 people in here. What if every person that's a Christian in here committed to doing one thing every week for 52 weeks of the year? That's at least 5,200 souls exposed to the gospel. At least. And so if you're a part of the church's evangelistic outreach on a weekly basis, and we say, hey, at least take four, because you might run into somebody, might keep you longer, we've got childcare. We're not trying to limit the Holy Spirit or put a time frame on him, but hey, take this or take 10, whatever is on your heart. But if 50 people reached out to four every week of the year, that's too much math for me to do. That's a lot more than 5,200. And so we fail to be consistent. And on that note, I want to encourage you. Every year we've seen the same thing. Outreach banquet's coming up about a week and a half, September 4th. And every year we have people, 70. One year we had close to 80, didn't we? And we just wrapped up outreach with 30-something people. And I know things come up and schedules change and we switch to Saturdays and it changes things, but let's be consistent in our evangelistic efforts. Let's be faithful to it. Number four is we fail to pray for evangelistic opportunities. And I've preached this for many years. What if every single one of us, from the pastor to staff members, church staff members, to ministry leaders, or church members in general, prayed every single day for the opportunity to share the gospel with at least one person. So I want to challenge you with that once again. Pray every day, God, send someone my way. God, send me in the path of somebody that needs to hear the truth. God, open my eyes to see an opportunity to give your truth to someone. Imagine what would happen if the combined power of praying met with intentional evangelism. Imagine what would happen. The fifth thing is this: we fail to do what's most important because we're busy doing the less important. I've shared that recently. Oftentimes we settle for what's good instead of striving for what's best. We also, and please listen, are sometimes pacified or satisfied with substituting church attendance and church activity involvement for personal responsibility to evangelize. It doesn't work like that. As you're involved in a ministry, it doesn't happen by default. Because you are at church faithfully, it doesn't happen by default. Every single one of us has to be responsible. Again, that's what we see in Nehemiah. They said, let's build the wall. Let's do it. Let's strengthen our hands and do every single one of us. I challenge you, I encourage you to go back, read Nehemiah chapter 3. See how every family, every person, everybody played a part. They were doing their part. And man, God got the victory. You read the end of 52 days. The wall was built in a miraculous way. God did some amazing things. He got the glory from it. Because the people had a mind to work. So in this church, from our children up, we want to make sure that people learn the mission. And not just learn the mission. That's good. I know what it is. But live the mission. I want my girls to know what the mission of the church is. But I don't want them just to learn it. I want them to see mom and dad live it. And then they in turn live it. And I want to see that for all of the kids in our church up through every senior citizen in our church. Play a part somehow. Speaking of our children, I'm almost done. We've done some things to ensure their safety. And in the process to ensure that there's a welcoming environment for our kids and for our parents. Next door in our children's area. We're going to have new check-in procedures, new check-out procedures. And I want to say this now tonight before we begin to implement that next month. I'm asking you, and I'm praying of you, to have a good attitude and embrace all the changes that are going on in the children's ministry, because I want you to understand it's simply for the protection of our kids, so that God can be glorified. We don't want anything to, in our watch, in our stewardship, to come in the way where God's glory can be stolen. We have to begin to focus on certain issues that we could alleviate if we just do some of these changes. There's a broader purpose than just putting up some walls, doors, and having a procedure that becomes inconvenient because it's not the way we always done it. It's a larger picture. And I'm asking you to have that good attitude and embrace those changes because, again, we're not out to inconvenience anybody. You've been a member here for 20-something years. You got kids. You say, listen, I don't need to go through that. I don't need to go follow those procedures. They know who I am. They know who I don't. Let's not have that take. We're not out to inconvenience anybody, but we simply want to make sure that we cross every T that we see needs to be crossed and dot every I that we see needs to be dotted. And protecting and caring for our kids. So please, be good-spirited and have a good spirit of cooperation through this. So what are we going to do? Every children's ministry is going to have a check-in. It's going to be at the same place. It's going to be everyone. Awana's, Sunday school, once you check your kids in, they're going to be checked in. What's going to happen is you're going to go up to the check-in counter. Physically, you have to walk up there and check your child in. You'll then get, we're going to call it a receipt. You're going to get a receipt for your kid, you know. Evidence that we have them and evidence that you let us have them. So we're going to today. You'll have this receipt. Consequently, you'll have to go check them out physically. You'll have two parts to this receipt that you can tear. One person can give it, here, grandma take this, grandpa take that, husband take that, wife take that, however you want to do it. Big sister, go check out little sister. We got a ticket, I might not like it. Don't send your five-year-old to go get a three-year-old. Please don't do that, But if they have the receipt, there you go. You gave them authority, that's what the process is going to be. You say, well, what? We're very forgetful people. We lose things all the time. So you're asking us to keep up two little pieces of paper? That's going to be hard to do. That's all right, because in the system that we have, we'll have a couple different security measures. Number one, you give a password when you register your kids. Here's the password. If I lose my papers, I can walk up here and say, yeah, Jesus Christ is my Savior. That's my password. You could do that. Or on the list, you'll have approved people to check your kids out. So what you'll have to do is have to have your ID. And you say, oh, I've been a member here for 20-something years. Listen, this applies to my kids too. Rochelle walks over there and she don't have the paper. I'm not going to be happy with our children's ministry people if they let our kids go to her without that receipt. We'll be talking on Monday, right, Brother Jason? And say, hey, this is not good. Rochelle walked out with Avery. Walked out with Avery and Addison. And she didn't have her receipt. Let's not let that happen. I'm honest. I'm not being silly. I want a safety protocol. That way, if newer members come on the scene and they're not quite sure, oh, you're the pastor's brother, you're the pastor's sister, you're the pastor this, you're the associate pastor's this, you're the that. Okay, so you can have the kids. You can do that. No. None of that stuff. Let's just have a safety protocol. Everybody happy? Happy, happy. Just smile and, hey, you know what? I don't have my ticket. Here's my ID. I need my kids. Praise the Lord. Let's have that spirit of cooperation so that we make sure that it's easy on the people checking in, checking out, that there's a good spirit of cooperation. Again, we're all ensuring the safety of the kids for the glory of God. We're not trying to make it difficult for anybody. We're not trying to make things busy or more difficult again. But we just want to make sure that there's a standard that we go by. So with all this, especially concerning the children's ministry, in this aspect, comes a need. And we need help. It's not time to pray. Some people, we have a need. We have a need. We have several needs. But I don't want to just talk about needs. I want you to get the vision in this as well. Not just about, well, man, I don't want to be a part of watching those bratty kids. It's seeing the vision that we need people to help protect our kids. To ensure that the kids that are back there have no distractions, no worries. That they can hear the word of God being taught to them. That they can, again, be free of anything. So that they can learn the vision. So that right alongside the home, as the home is teaching and training, the church is a place of safety. The church is a place they can learn exactly what mom and dad is teaching them to. Those kids begin to grow up and be nurtured, and all the tools are being added to them so that they can be part of the work, so they can put their hands to the wall and help build when they get old enough. So we need some people. So you know what? I'll volunteer. All in effort to glorify God. I'll serve. I'll grab that part of the wall so that God is glorified and the Great Commission is accomplished. So, what are the specific needs? With this new checkout procedure and check-in and checkout procedure, we need some people who have or will be members 6 months, go through the background check, be certified, and stand at that counter with a smile on your face, with patience and love and kindness in your heart, and bear with the people that may be standing there like. I know. Just bear with me 1 second. You know? We need some people that will just check people in and stay there in case there's an emergency and mom needs to come back and usher them back in. Because here's the deal. Once the kids are checked in and once Sunday school's over, the door that leads to the education hallway is going to be an electric strike. And so you're going to have to be let in or let out. Same thing for the door that gets back to the nursery and toddlers and into the children's church area. The person that's manning that is going to know, they're going to be trained, that these are the only people, workers with children are the only ones back there allowed to be back there. Unless it's a mother that comes back and needs to get her baby, or someone needs to take care of their kid, or needs to check their kid out, or whatever. It's all for, not trying to be mean. Hey, listen, hey, no, I tithe to this church, and I've been here for 25 years, and ain't nobody going to tell me I can't go back there. Come on. We're not trying to make it difficult. We're just trying to ensure the safety. We're not thinking that you're crazy. Well, maybe if that's the attitude. No, I mean, but we just want to make sure that we have the same protocol every time. So, we need that. We also need nursery, toddler, and preschool. It's always the deal. But see the vision in that. There are parents that are in here that are being blessed by that ministry right now. And if you're one of those parents that's being blessed by that children's ministry, or maybe your kid's sitting by you here and on Sunday mornings they're next door and it's a blessing to you to be here, to focus on your worship to God collectively in this corporate worship, if you're being blessed by that, then be a blessing as well by being a part of serving, volunteering back there. Hey, my kid's back there. You know what? I can work one service. If every parent did that, every parent would probably only have to work one service a month. One service a month. Not one service a week, like many of our workers in the nursery, toddler, and preschool do. Not one service a week. Well, I only can do this because I got to be in church 2 times. No, if every parent, and even grandparents, would say, I'll work back there one service. I'll man that check-in. Absolutely. If they did that, people would only be out of service one service a month. I promise. You can run the math. You can look at it. And that's exactly what the reality is. So I encourage you, if the children's ministry is a blessing to you and your family, and I'm not talking about the guys. You just don't want me in the children's church. I promise that. I mean, maybe once or twice I can do something. I can, you know, I love the kids. But after a while, the women are wired differently than men. That's just the reality. And God gives special gifts to certain men. Praise the Lord. I'm just joking. I think I can deal with it. But we need people back there. But we also need people to help volunteer with the van ministry. There's a potential to reach over 60 kids, around 60 kids, every week with our church vans that could hear the gospel, that could maybe go back to their single-parent home, that could go back to their broken home, they go back to their alcoholic-filled home. They go back to their drug-filled home and be a light to their family. We have the potential to do that. We need volunteers to help with our van ministry so that we could reach the potential in that. It's about putting our hands to the work. We also have a need for Awana workers. We've been taking some Awana workers. And again, this could not only minister to those 60 kids, but other kids on top of that. Again, if you've been a member for 6 months, had a background check, been certified, you can be a part. It's all an effort to impact others for the kingdom of God, for God's glory. Anybody who comes in contact with TBT, whether it's out in our community or they come to us, we want to make sure that we're doing that, having that impact for the kingdom of God. So now I hope that you see that change is healthy. Not change just for change, but right change. It has to happen in order for growth to come. I want to ask Brother Jim to come. And I pray that you'll strengthen your hands for the good work ahead. that you'll see the changes, embrace them and run and have a mind to work. And together we'll see God's kingdom built. We'll see God's kingdom advanced. But not, maybe you're at a place where you've been skeptical. I don't know about all this. You know, church isn't what it used to be. Maybe you've been reserved. Maybe you've been fearful. Maybe you've been doubting or whatever. You've been holding back from diving and embracing. Specifically concerning being deliberately involved in the Great Commission, the work of the church. Then I ask you to come tonight to this altar and ask God, God, help me to have the faith. God, help me to have whatever I need so that I can help build the wall, so that my hands are strengthened for the work in whatever way, whatever measure that you have for me to be a part of. Maybe you've been working. Maybe you've been a part of it. Maybe you've been serving. You come to a place in your service that the changes in church have become the focus instead of the Lord and His purpose. And maybe you need to come tonight and say, God, help me center on You. Help me focus on You. Help me just run the race. Be a part of what the church is doing and try to reach the lost and disciple those that are won. And you know what? God, I need Your help to be faithful despite the distractions that may come. So no matter where you're at, I encourage you. Maybe you're doing fine. Hey, I'm excited, man. I'm excited to see the gospel. I'm excited to see discipleship. I'm a part of it. I'm involved. Then come and pray for more laborers. Come tonight and say, God, send laborers. Help us, God. Help us, God. Convict the hearts. Challenge the people. Help us be unified, God. Bring laborers so that we can do Your work. Let's pray. Father, we come before You. God, I thank You for Your word. Lord, thank You for an example like Nehemiah. It wasn't easy. Change is never easy. Especially when it's for You, God. We know that the enemy likes to attack and discourage and distract. But God, tonight, I pray that there would be group of people, maybe who haven't been involved, that would come tonight and say, God, I want to be involved. I want to be a part of the work. I pray that our church as a whole, we would get the vision together, and we together would build the wall You have for us, God. Unify us. Just have Your way now. Praise You, Lord Jesus. We'll stand. And as they sing, I encourage you to come. Pray, God, help us.
Coming home, coming home.
being here. And I just encourage you to be in prayer. Make sure that you're doing everything you need. I want to say this real quick.
Is this working? It's good? No? Good? All right. Praise the Lord. We need prayer partners. We need people that are going to labor in prayer as we go out into our community. And so maybe you've never gone out and knocked a door. Maybe you're real shy and hesitant to do that. You say, well, that's just not me. I want to be a part. Then be a part. Come up when we start on Thursday nights and pray for those of us who are going out. And maybe your health won't allow you to go out and go door to door. Maybe you can't do that. But you can meet up here and you can call out the people's names who are going out and knocking doors. And you can pray. You can be an encouragement. You could serve. You could watch kids. Be a part and see what God will do. We have regular service coming up on Sunday, but there is no p.m. service. That's correct, right? No p.m. service. And then the following week is when we have a bunch of stuff going on. We have school and institute starting, and we have our outreach banquet that next week. And then the following Sunday is our first responder Sunday. And I just want to go ahead and say that now. If you've got a family member or a friend or a neighbor who doesn't have a church home and they are a first responder, please invite them to come out. The Saturday before that service, which I think is September 6th, we're going to be taking some food around to the local fire departments and police stations here in our area. And just be a blessing to them. We're going to leave gospel tracts with them and invitations to the services the next day. And but we want to encourage you, invite the people that you know that are first responders. We just want to just praise God for them, acknowledge them in a service, and also maybe they need the gospel. And so you can have them come here and they can hear it. So that's a bunch of stuff coming up. Again, if you have any questions, you want to be a part, you want to serve in the children's ministry, please see Brother Jason Ritter, and he can show you what needs there are and exactly what needs to go on as far as certification, all that kind of stuff. So, again, God bless you. I hope you have a wonderful week. Yes, sir.
The Salt Life Fellowship is changed to, it's going to be located at Brother Ricky's house.
Brother Ricky, Salt and Light Fellowship.
Same day, same time.
Okay. Okay. And the breakfast is still in the morning, right? Senior breakfast in the morning? Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, let's pray. Father, we come before you again, Lord. We just exalt your name, Lord. We worship you and we praise you, Lord, for who you are. And we're so thankful once again that we had an opportunity to open your word. God, help us walk out of this place tonight realizing that change is healthy when it's change that you've ordained. God, whenever you've called for the change, Lord, it's the only way for us to grow. Lord, that's for us individually, but it's also us as a church. Lord, I pray that each person, each member of Trinity Baptist Temple would grab full hold of their part, their individual part in this work, in the kingdom work, God. Lord, that we could see the fullest potential of what you have for this church come to reality. And Lord, we'll praise you for what you do. Help us go out this week and be a light. Lord, help us be deliberate. Help us be intentional, Lord, to give the gospel to those in need. Lord, we'll praise you for everything that you do. I ask you to just take us home safely now. We'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.